Talk Radio.
My son, welcome to the war room. We got Dez, Kim, Jimmy, PJ, B. Austin, the Hot Block Commander.
How you wanna end a 1 or 2 hour show to get the brain running with the premise of talk sports on a national level? Bold with the topic, sort of like the rubber. When it's game time, they like the Fab Five during prime time. Sports conglomerates speak their minds a little bit. For sports medicine and sports veterans and greats. The 4 for 26, so the war in Kuwait. It's the war room with 5 nights at the round table. 5 Philly guys, diversified and educated.
What up, everybody out there in War Room Nation? You're once again live in the War Room, brought to you by War Room Sports and Sports the Book on the WRS Podcast Network. I'm Devin McMillan. I'm at the round table as usual with the homie, Jimmy the Blueprint Williams, and the boy B. Austin. The Super Bowl is set. 2 weeks of coverage begins now, so keep it locked right here. And if you want to holler at us throughout the show, join us right now in the JW Philly Realty chat room at blogtalkradio.com/thewarroom. Or join us on Facebook or Twitter at War Room Sports. You can call us directly in about 30 minutes. That's when we open up the Digital Extreme Tech hotline at 323-410-0012. And as usual, when we're not live on the air, we'd like for all of you guys to check us and all of our network mates out on the War Room Sports Podcast Network. Just visit warroomsports.com, click on the WRS Podcast Network tab, or listen on the War Room Sports mobile app or on iTunes. You'll find some of the best shows the net has to offer, sports and non-sports. I promise you, they're some of the best shows. And you can listen to archive episodes of our show, The War Room, The Broad Street Line, with Roy and Chris. Shout out to those guys, The Tissue and the Tape Hip Hop Show, with Phil and Survive, The No Look Pass Podcast with Andy and Frank, The Mad Scientist Sports Lab with The Mad Scientist and His Apprentice, and a whole lot more. You can also check out the listings over on FatsRadio.com for syndicated airtimes of all your favorite WRSPN sports shows, including The War Room, which airs over there a few times per week. Fellas, man, have y'all completely dug out yet from Snowcules or Snowmageddon or whatever else you're the Snowpocalypse?
No.
Whatever you want to call it.
No. No, I haven't. And I'm just done coming through these streets of the illustrious DMV, a.k.a. the District of Columbia, a.k.a. well, we won't go on with the a.k.a.s, but yeah.
The area.
The streets are terrible, and, you know, the local municipalities are taking a brutal beating for their response. But to be honest, man, we had like 37 inches of snow. I'm not even that mad. I mean, there's nowhere to put the stuff. It exacerbates the traffic problems. It took me an hour and 45 minutes to go 8 miles. 8 miles!
Right.
No M&M.
Yo, it is crazy out there. Like, I measured just in my driveway, like, I think the highest point I measured was like 24 inches. But, hey, you know, that's enough. That's 2 feet of snow right there. And I don't have a snowblower. I think I'm going to invest in one of those. I think I'm going to do it in the summertime, though, because, you know, I walked into Lowe's on Friday with the intentions of getting a snowblower. But, you know, I've never owned anything outside of a townhouse. This is the first time I'm in a single family joint. Yeah, I walked in there with like $250. I got to the snowblower section at John. The cheapest one was $800. I was like, okay, pass me that sand and that salt right over there. I had one shovel.
Yo.
One shovel, 2 feet of snow, like 60 feet of driveway just to be able to get out.
You got you a good workout.
But before I worked out, though, B, I read all of these articles of how people were shoveling themselves to death, like strokes and heart attacks because they were out of shape. And I'm out of shape, so I was nervous whole time.
Dev went and bought a plantation and now don't want to take care of it. Plantation, you need somebody to take care of it, right? You know, the next logical step.
I know. Yeah, it is a plant, you know. Have to find me some nice young bucks.
It's only one thing you can
do. I'm sure Donald Trump would support that. He ain't got no problem. His supporters would say, you know how to staff out a plantation, don't you, boy? Candy land.
I'm going to just do it, you know, I'm going to tough it out. I don't know how many storms we're going to have left. But I'm pretty sure if I try to cop a snowblower in the summertime, it'll be at a great discount in comparison to, you know, trying to get one day before a diesel storm is coming. They probably marked everything up. So my next purchase, even though it's wintertime, is not going to be a snowblower. My next purchase is going to be a grill because I'm using that same logic. Get a grill in the winter, get a snowblower in the summer, save some money.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that makes sense. If I say, let us know how it works out, because now these days they know that you're thinking like that. You know what I'm talking about? I don't even feel right talking about the snow, because we didn't get hit the way you guys got hit. You know what I'm saying? It was tremendous. So we got about a little over 20. Y'all got 30. Y'all damn near doubled us up.
Yeah. Austin's out there.
36 inches of snow. 30. Yeah. I mean, I don't even know what the. Yo.
Well, I couldn't lead a block, so since I didn't get as much as B. Austin, I've probably never seen 36 inches of snow. Like,
ladies,
that's ridiculous.
Ladies, and the only way that we knew it was 36 is I had to use three legs to walk.
Oh, man. That's our cue, man. That's when it's time, though. And shout out to all the people from the Midwest. Y'all know how when things happen that people from other regions are used to, they always clowning everybody. Oh, go back to school already. Oh, look at the streets. Okay, you live in a place that's likened to damn Antarctica. Good for you. But y'all know some regions aren't built for that kind of weather. They don't have the infrastructure. They don't have the equipment to deal with that kind of weather. So don't be assholes. Like, come on, man. Like, yeah, you ain't got to do that.
It's all relative. Yeah. I remember last year in Atlanta, which needs to be like blown away anyway. But listen though, last year in Atlanta,
oh,
they had
Sodom.
Like freezing
Atlanta,
rain.
Atlanta, Sodom,
like,
yeah, Sodom and Gomorrah in Georgia. No, they got literally an inch and a half of ice. I know exactly what you're about to say.
Yo, that joint shut the city down. It was accidents everywhere. People was committing suicide. It was like mayhem.
Yo, it was people stuck on the highway. But you can't knock it. They're not used to that. That's hot Atlanta. They're not used to snow.
Saying.
I mean, it's snowing down there for a reason. You know what I mean? Like, you know,
it's
hell freeze over.
Man.
Same thing.
Shout out to all our listeners in Atlanta, man. We got a lot of support in Atlanta. I love you,
man.
You know what I'm saying? Y'all cop
right on. Don't be a-holes about the whole situation. That's like when we had our little tiny earthquake. To us, that's not tiny. Everybody over in the West Coast clowning. Ah, y'all had that little thing and y'all scared. Like, first of all, we don't have earthquake insurance over here. So when the foundation of my house is cracked and I'm hearing floors squeaking since the time that happened, like, who's going to pay for that? And y'all over there laughing. Like, what?
Anyway,
you darn right
I was
scared when the earth was shaking. You darn right.
Dog, I'm still shook from that. Like, that's still an experience I'll never forget. I'm like, yo,
hey,
I felt like I was in a movie. I know nothing about that life at all.
Hey, and I'm not about,
you know,
that
saying?
Life whatsoever. So
I mean,
keep you
laughing. I'm from the Upper East Coast, man. Like, yo, somebody could walk up and clap somebody in the head next to me, and like, I'd be cool with that.
You'd be
that
cool.
Nothing, that's what we deal with. But no, not no earthquake, though, B. That's a whole different story. Yeah, anyway, man. Enough about that. Let's get to these sports, man. It's time to talk about what happened while the people were on the great grind this week, getting that chicken. If you like a better TV experience than cable has to offer, which includes the NFL Sunday Ticket, you're going to need it next season to watch the Broncos after they win their Super Bowl, just go to our website at warroomsports.com and click on that DirecTV logo and order a better TV experience at a discounted War Room Sports sign-up rate. Call yourself a sports fan? How can you not have DirecTV? Step your life up. Gentlemen, tons of stories this week, but let's start with something positive. Let's start with the positive this week.
We usually don't do
that.
We always start with something ratchet.
Let's talk about the great light-skinned brother, Devin George. I mean, usually in life, you can never trust a cat-eyed Negro, but Devin George has built affordable housing grocery co-op in his hometown in Minneapolis. He's trying to give back to the community by building affordable housing as well as grocery, you know, to go with it. What do you guys think about this deed by the retired Devin George?
First of all, every city has a hood. You know, a lot of cities have multiple hoods. You don't really think of that when you think of Minnesota and Minneapolis, but they do. You know, when I think of that, I think of cold, because Minneapolis is actually the coldest place I've ever been in my life. that has
you don't remember
nothing
you don't remember
do.
Cuckoo Cow in my projects.
I don't listen to that kind of music. I'm not familiar with his body of work. I don't
his
even know what you're
stretch.
Talking about. But no, shout out
Jimmy
to
knows.
Devin George, because it's always good, you know, when you hear a positive story about an athlete or a former athlete, you know, giving back to his community, because those aren't the type of stories we hear. I mean, we just said it. We usually start out with something ratchet. This is something positive. So, you know, he deserves a shout out for that. And like, nobody's heard of Devin George for the past 5-6 years. So to reemerge with a story that is this positive, that's, you know, kudos to him, man. And cool cow, whoever the hell BS I'm talking about.
In my project.
Oh, that dude.
Yo, that's the only part of that song I know. It's catchy.
Yo, that's the only part I know. Only part. Salute to Devin George. You didn't have much game, but you got good game in the game of life. So, you know, salute to you.
Devin George is a champion, man. You're a champion.
Yeah. So is Randy Brown.
Yeah, he got more rings than Barkley.
So is J.R. Ryder, and he was wearing a suit when he won a ring. So.
Robert Horry is in the top power forward conversation. Because of
Robert Horry, a Hall of Famer, dude.
Yeah, I'll smack the issue out.
Yo, he did something, though. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, man, salute to Devin George, man. We ain't hear from you forever, man. Way to show back up doing something positive as opposed to something negative. You know what I'm saying? You trying to rep for the light-skinned brothers. Speaking of light-skinned brothers and not repping right, Blake Griffin injured his hand in a fight with the Clippers equipment staffer.
Dude.
What you got to think about that?
Jim, hold up. You're talking about the same dude. The same dude who every power forward in the NBA punks when he comes to town. The same dude who's afraid of Z-Bo out in Memphis, but he wants to have a fist fight with the equipment staffer of the Clippers at a Toronto restaurant. I heard he punched the dude and kept punching the dude, broke his hand on the dude's face. I'm pretty sure the equipment staffer is probably like 5'6", 160 pounds. This dude is 6'10", 250, and gets punked by every power forward in the league, but you want to fight the dude who irons your uniform. Like, really?
I actually would like to speculate as to what happened.
All right. Just send that disclaimer. Make sure everybody knows this is the War Room speculation game.
This does not represent the views or beliefs of the War Room. This is not factual. This is all alleged. But it might be. Like, what happened was, I don't know if you guys noticed, you probably do, if you're like me and this thing of ours. Equipment managers are very valuable members of the staff in an NBA organization. Like, they literally pack up a player's everything. You're thinking of uniform and sneakers, but we're talking about their clothes. They're like a valet for their dry cleaning. And so what happened was, we finally reached a point where that guy got tired of picking up ladies' lingerie from Blake cross-dressing. And he decided, look, man, you're not going to be disrespecting me and you paying extortion money to Matt Barnes to protect you. I'm going to let the world know who you really are, and I'm going to expose you. And we caught you with the ladies' heels on, and you consulted DeAndre Jordan and told him it was cool to do that commercial. So you wanted that place, and so the equipment manager came out the side of the neck. Blake got angry, realized that his secret was about to be revealed, and they just had at it. I mean, that's what it is, man. But
I thought it was
sir.
I got a whole different theory. Before I give my theory to us, I got to say something to y'all. The man you're down to wants to quit now. Y'all better get it with respect. Because I ain't a playboy day up in my project. My project. Yo, that cuckoo cow? Anyway, man, in my project. Anyway,
found Cuckoo Cow.
Anyway, salute to Cuckoo Cow, man.
That's the only song he ever had.
There's no place on earth where you're being talked about this week or this year or this decade other than here in the world. So salute to Cuckoo Cow, man. Now, with that being said, my man got a hook. He's a one hook wonder.
That's disrespectful because I wouldn't call that a hit. That got to the top 300 on BET.
BET After Dark, BET Uncut. Listen, though, Blake Griffin, I think it's a situation where everybody treats Blake Griffin like a young boy and a sucker. And the equipment manager was like, look, I see everybody else treating like a sucker, so I'm going to try him, too. And he started talking greasy to him. And Blake had to put him in his place like, yo, you're not a grown man or an athlete, so I got to put these hands on you. So he kind of got fed up with being bullied by everybody. He was, you know, getting bullied even by the staff at this point. So he stood up to the young man. You know what I mean? With Blake Griffin, you still should be ashamed of yourself because you know you have to know how this is going to come out. Any move you make, you know what I'm saying? You're like, you know that it's going to be reported.
But then
I like my version better.
But the worst part about it is he hurt himself fighting the equipment staffer. He had a quad injury, and he was about to come back this week. Now he had to have an operation on his hand because he was fighting the equipment staffer. Yo, Blake.
So that makes
sense. I know you tried to prove that you're a tough guy, but yo.
Well, we don't believe you. You need more people.
Yo, you saw it, dude. That's all I'm gonna say. All I'm gonna say is you saw it.
Every athlete at every level knows, yo, you don't fight or bully the equipment manager, though. That's like picking on the retarded. Come on, man.
Yo. It's like this, man. You have to understand that anything you do will be reported. I mean, it's in 2016, it's to the point now where if LeBron blows his nose, it's an article on Bleacher Report about it. So when you live in a world like this, right, and no shots at Bleacher Report, but y'all do realize y'all be putting up some BS, though. So you know you live in a world like that this is no way. Let's just say this doesn't happen. Let's just say you, like, you know, you get over him and you beat his ass. You still lose. Let's say he beat your ass. You still lose. Really? Let's say that we don't know who beat whose ass, but you break your hand. You still lose. There's no wins in this, dog. You ain't got the wins in me. Like, what are you doing?
That's a really good point.
Yeah, it's no
Jimmy,
wins in this, man.
Before we move on, let me ask both you gentlemen. A long time ago, we came up with the idea of the War Room Sports Big Brothers, Athletes Big Brother program, where we would step in and kind of be the old head. Like somewhere between an uncle, a pop, and a big brother. Like not quite your dad, you know, because we would condone how you behave with the groupies properly. Not quite your uncle because we ain't drunks. But more than your brother because we can give you sound financial advice. So somewhere in the midst of the three. Do you think that Blake needs that? Do you think he needs an intervention?
I think half the league needs that, man.
I was about to say, I think had we started that, we could take on half the league as clients, man.
Yeah. I mean, they all need somebody to take them to the Gucci store and show them the loafs. They all need that. Anyway.
True.
With that being said, man, like, keeping it gutter, because we started off with the positive story.
You're showing them growth.
We're going all negative now. Vince Young, Dream Team. Vince Young was arrested on DWI charges.
I hate him. Good.
My man Vince Young. who loves to, like, frequent certain restaurants and blow money fast. And, yeah, I mean, he likes to dance in the club with his shirt off. Is still making news by getting arrested on the DWI charge. What's up with your ex?
And he ain't got
Vince
no
Young?
Money.
Well, B. Austin, speaking of his money situation, I think the most important part of this story is the fact that he has a $100,000 job with the University of Texas as an analyst on the Longhorn Network. What the hell Vince Young know about football to be an analyst?
Hey,
I know a lot of people
football,
are mad as hell that I just said that. Anyway.
Yeah, they don't know that. They don't. That, that's a whole nother can of worms that you'll have to explain at some point. That your favorite heroes from the NFL that get on TV and talk, yo, they don't be knowing about football, yo. They know about their position, and they know what their position coach told them to go and do.
Nah,
and
he's a quarterback.
No,
he don't
idea
know about that.
Yo, he don't know. He don't
blitzes,
know
progressions. Nah, not Vince Young.
Nah.
Anyway, like how many chances does Vince Young get? Because actually, you know, he didn't lose his job over this, and I'm not an advocate of people losing their job every time they get in trouble, but dude gets in trouble a lot. The network is keeping him, but this is not his first DUI. You know what I'm saying? This is nowhere near his first brush ball. You know, he had some brushes with depression before, so we don't know what's going on in this man's head, but he got to get it together, man. Vince Young, like, you're out of the league now. You're still out there messing up. Wrong with you?
Yeah, I mean, you said it all needs to be said about Vince Dunn. I'm surprised we often call him his world nickname. So I had to bring it up, obviously. I mean, dream team. So, you know, and then I can say that Vince Young, man, get your life together, B. You got a six-figure job. You are a god in that university, and I get it. Like, you won the chip and all that. So
that's why you got a job.
You know they want,
the only reason.
You know they're going to take care of you. Like, you know what I'm saying? Anyway.
I don't have any opinion. I have a bias because he came to my team that I root for and said that mess. So I'm automatically in favor, you know, of him getting a death penalty for
damn!
Well, we got another.
Yo, the four letters, for those who don't know our colloquialisms, the four letters are the E, the S, the P, and the N. They suspend Bob Ryan for criticizing Mark Jackson. He was calling him like a fake holy roller and, you know, talking about how Mark Jackson is, you know, such a man of God, but he likes to, outside of his marriage, go partake in other yamage. So, yeah, Bob Ryan kind of went in on Mark Jackson and, you know, ESPN suspended him for it. Obviously, he went and apologized on Twitter, as everybody does these days.
The thing was, because he was on the Levitar show, and he went in on him. I don't even read that part, but he called him, you know, a Bible-pounding phony within that whole diatribe. And then Levitar said to him, like, Bob, that was savage, like what you just did. A legitimate Bible pounder? And then his answer was, yeah, because he's a phony. That's all. Well, I'm sorry, but it's the truth. And I can't believe they took him back on that broadcast. Oh, my God, he's a con man. And he's done very well at it. I'll give him credit for being a great one. That sounds like something real personal. Like there was something between Mark Jackson and Bob Ryan. I mean, I've heard Bob Ryan speak his mind on things before, but I've never heard it get this personal.
It was something between them. You know they don't grow.
Mark Jackson.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I mean? One of the young ladies that Mark Jackson likes to spend time with away from his wife. You know what I'm saying? Maybe he should move to what country was that, Austin? What's that country you got to get two chicks? Anyway, maybe him and
Eritrea.
Bob.
Eritrea.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Mark Eritrea Jackson. Maybe he needs to relocate. But the fact of the matter is, Bob Ryan, he ain't had to go that hard. But this sounds like a little love triangle type thing. Like I'm gonna speculate. This isn't the war room, but you know what I'm saying? Like we also just speculated. My speculation is there's a young lady somewhere that she's familiar with Bob Ryan in an adult way, and she's also familiar with Mark Jackson.
Hold up, Jim. Come on, dog. You seen Bob Ryan? Bob Ryan,
listen,
ugly as
he got
guy.
Chicken. Bob
Ryan looked like the bull from he looked like the bug dude from Men in Black. The bull.
Bob, when does that matter?
No, but it's not just ugly. Like he seems nasty. Like Bob Ryan seems like he stinks. Like he would have to have a lot of
but you don't realize that in 2016, the price of the yamage is at an all time low. I mean, you know, Tyrone Hill is out here with models. Like, it don't matter. That don't matter to them.
Bob Ryan, my man, he
got a walking head cold, like, all the time.
Yo, when it gets to a point in society when Eric Williams can poop on beautiful women, you know Bob Ryan can do some damage. I mean,
yeah, Eric Williams is kind of beautiful.
Yeah, I mean, look at
him. Eric Williams is like
all,
Predator.
Yo, man, yo, chicks out here struggling, B. I mean, you know what I mean? It's like
Bob Ryan, though?
Don't matter, man.
Yo, Bob Ryan, man. Yo, you don't understand what's going on with the – see, I'm kind of the bridge between
He looked
Dez
like he spit when he
Jimmy
talked.
For our listeners.
And, like, his nose, like, running all the time. He just looked like that.
Because
a chick will lay with you if you got medical benefits. That's all you need. Like, it don't take much. The price of the image is at an all-time low in 2016, B. It don't even matter.
Oh.
Yo,
it don't even matter.
I mean, Welvin, like, who ain't got no suck?
Yeah. who ain't got no
suck? No, he was serious, too.
He was Welvin.
Welvin. If A-Town can get, if A-Town can make a porno, come on, man. Bob Ryan can win.
A chick was with him on camera. Like, come on, man. It's 2016. That it ain't worth nothing no more. Yeah. That market is diluted. Anyway, with all that being said, man, that's my speculation. that was personal. And there's a young lady who knows them both in an intimate way. That's just my thought.
That's mad.
What you guys got, man? Y'all feel like y'all done with this one. I'm just gonna move on.
That's for the girl that's least, between them that we don't know about.
I mean, at least Bob Ryan is probably paying for it. You know what I'm saying? Some people don't pay for it. Jameis Winston's accuser.
Speaking of not paying for it.
I wasn't gonna say it.
Yo, y'all
more than hell. Yo, we have no sponsors left. Go ahead. Jameis Winston.
Florida State. FSU was going to pay Jameis accuser $950,000 in a settlement. Now, I don't know how true this part is, but I read in one article that $700,000 was in lawyer fees.
Yeah,
she's getting
skeptic. Oh, I ain't going to say that.
So she kind of got it twice. No, Ma.
Come on, man. Yo,
I had to take a commercial break, man.
The young lady is not reaping the rewards of sacrificing her dignity via that possible lie, because the attorney was able to realize, listen, she's really getting extorted by her attorney. Her attorney said, come on, listen, look, you know what it is. It's a premium on pooping on high-profile African-American athletes. I can make this happen for you, but you know that this didn't really go down. So I'm going to need most of that bread if I'm going to do all of this work, because you didn't do no work.
I was just going to ask on a serious note, though, B, how does this make the situation look? Like, how does the school look when you have to settle like this when the guy is supposed to be innocent? Like, how in this play
innocent,
out for
innocent,
schools in the future where they have situations like
three, this? Three factors to this, and I'm pretty sure the brother JW, the Blueprint, a.k.a. Jimmy Williams, a.k.a. the author, has something to say about this. But three things: criminal guilt, civil guilt, and actually being in the wrong, they're totally unrelated, unfortunately. So what happens is people – and institutions in these type of situations, they'll often pay to make it go away, whether they're guilty or not. They're just like, look, it's nothing for us to stroke a check for $1 million to get rid of you and appease our boosters who are uncomfortable with the thought of Jameis Winston taking it from a lily white young lady in the first place. We'll pay to make it go away.
I'll be very brief with this amazing analysis I'm getting ready to offer, because B. Austin pretty much said what he said. I know Jimmy's going to have something to say, then said exactly what I was going to say. FOH. Listen, because all I was going to say is, like, OJ was considered innocent as well, right? So, I mean, being innocent and being perceived innocent, being found to be innocent are two different things. And at the same time, sometimes it's less to make this just go away. Like B. Austin said, they figured, look, let's give her this quick check. You know what I'm saying? Her lawyers are probably somehow in collusion with the school anyway. They got more slaves coming to the plantation next semester. I mean, more athletes, college athletes coming to play for FSU, because that's all on the up and up, and they're not taking advantage of the kids. So they figure this is nothing. By the way, I just read an article in Forbes magazine about the richest college football program. I'm going to send it to you guys. I'm going to screenshot it because it's a digital magazine. I shouldn't say that on air.
I know.
But, Yo, Texas is number one. Yo, Texas is worth like a Billy. Yo, the amount of money that some of these colleges.
Tim, that's why it's nothing to them to give Vince Young a job on TV.
They gave Vince Young crumbs. Like, here, my slick Rick voice. Crumbs.
Yo.
Like, this is us saving you from homelessness.
Whoever the CFO is, it rolled Vince Young's compensation plan into their tax treatment for those years. They're like, look, man, we'd rather pay some charity rather than pay tax on this, you know, this money. That's
but
all
here,
that
here's what y'all don't get though. When Vince Young signed to play with Texas, this was part of him signing. When I get out of the league, I got this deal coming back, you know what I'm saying? You know, but that's either here nor there.
True,
I'm not saying that college athletes get paid. You know what I'm saying? You know. Anyway, what all that means
is probably a situation where he went to Texas, he worked for Texas. I mean, he played for Texas. He went to the league, and then he went back to Texas to make exactly what he was making when he was there the first time. So, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. You know, as a Yakubian told me on Facebook this week, like Cam Newton and Vince Young all have gotten paid. You know, some of them take pay cuts to go to the league. You know what I mean? So, you know, but we'll get into that kind of conversation later. Let's table that for a minute, and let's give some birthday shout-out.
Oh, man, we're about to get cut off. All right, man. The birthdays, as usual, brought to you by Digital Extreme Technologies. Do you or your business need a custom website? Well, for dynamic, professional, and most of all, affordable custom website solutions, you need Digital Extreme Technologies. No need to break the bank for an effective online presence. Top quality, results-driven websites at incredibly affordable prices. For you cheap dudes, financing options are available, so you can get a website note. Just remember that. Get your web note. Visit DigitalExtremeTech.com or call 267-205-4203. And for discounted rates, be sure to tell them War Room Sports sent you.
It's my birthday. Yay!
All right, and we're going to give a shout-out to the great coach of the San Antonio Spurs, Greg Popovich, turns 67. Shout-out to Pop. Andre Iguodala, NBA Finals MVP, turns 32. Shout out to the other AI, Iggy. Dante Culpepper turns 39 today. Shout out to Dante Culpepper. Had one of the greatest seasons in quarterbacking history, but he did it at the same time that Peyton Manning probably had the greatest season in quarterbacking history, so he wasn't even acknowledged for it.
Had a spark when he started. Now he's just way out of the league.
Hey, at least he got nominated, though. At least he got nominated.
He didn't get the Oscar.
Who else we got today? We got another one of Jimmy's homies from his L.A. Lakers. Mark Madsen, Madman, turns 40. Tony Delk. Shout out to Tony Delk, who turns 42. And a hometown legend. Hometown for you guys who are just listening for us is Philadelphia. Jerome Pooh Allen turns 43 years old. Shout out to Pooh Allen. Don't let them steal your move. They've been trying to give it to Sham God all these years, but we know who's it is.
The FOH Sham God. We know where it started.
So we like to get a nice big warm room salute to all of these folks on their birthdays.
My birthday. Yay.
All right, we need a quick break because these dudes tripping. So, you know, while they're taking a quick break, I'm going to tell you guys how you can get in touch with War Room Sports. You can check out our website at warroomsports.com. While you're there, be sure to sign up for the War Report. Click on the Contact Us tab to send us a message about the company, the show, to inquire about sponsorship and advertising opportunities, or even join in the network for general inquiries. Email us, info@warroomsports.com. While you're browsing the site, make sure you look around. Click on the memorabilia tab. Buy some War Room Sports merchandise. Click the blog tab. Read our latest articles in the All's Fair in Sports and War blog. You can click the respective icons and tabs to like our Facebook page, Instagram page, to follow us on Twitter, subscribe to our iTunes podcast, to watch our webcast at War Room Sports TV, to listen to the WRS Podcast Network and all those great shows I told you about in the open, and to download our free War Room Sports mobile app to get everything I just mentioned on the go. Join the JW Philly Realty chat room right now during the show at blogtalkradio.com/thewarroom. To enter the chat room, just sign up for a free profile on Blog Talk Radio. If you don't want to do that, or if you're just lazy, you can sign in through your Facebook and Twitter accounts. And while you're at it, Click follow. That'll get you updates and reminders about the show. We'll be taking questions and reading posts from Facebook, Twitter, and the chat room during the show. But if you want to call in and speak with us, the Digital Extreme Technologies hotline is now open at 323-410-0012. Press 1 when prompted. If you're already listening from your phone, just press 1 if you want to talk, man. Let's get into some hot topics real quick. I know we got some calls on the line. We can actually take those if you guys want to do that because, you know, we got really one hot topic this week, and it's the treatment of one Cameron Newton leading up to this Super Bowl and throughout this Super Bowl run. So, Jimmy, tell everybody who hot topics were brought to him by real quick, and then we can take some calls, and then we can get into that Cam conversation.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Well, I'll tell y'all.
Hot topics are brought to you by Audible.
I listen, my fault, Aki. I was actually muting myself to get all these messages people are sending us from Facebook and whatnot, and then I started reading and forget that I was on mute. I was going in on this ad.
Yo, anyway, we in the studio, man.
If your schedule is too hectic to read as much as you would, try audiobooks. Kick back and let someone do the reading for you. Go to audibletrial.com/warroomsports, and we got it set up, right? Look how we set this up. You get a free audiobook. That's right. Free 99 on us. And there's tons of great sports books. My new thing in 2016 is like, yo, do your history, man. There's all kinds of great sports books which give you all kinds of information. Wilt Chamberlain, Bill Russell, Jim Brown, Michael Jordan, Magic Johnson, Larry Bird. The list goes on and on where you can do all kinds of research. And look, you can start for free. audibletrial.com/warroomsports. Salute to Audible for their support of this podcast, The War Room. Listen, man, we got to get to some of these callers.
Yeah, go do that.
Absolutely. Homie called. He's been on hold for a minute. Let's get him first. Let's get the homie Tobias calling in, man. Yo, Tobias is a funny dude, man. What's up, good brother?
Roll Tide. Hey, I was hoping Fred would have called in, you know. No, his tail probably tucked between his legs what happened last weekend. You know, but here's the thing. Let's talk about this whole Cam Newton thing while I'm up. I know everybody's talking about how
we going to get into it, brother. You just listen up. We going to get into it.
Yeah,
well, go ahead.
He can start it off.
Yeah. You know, first audio book probably great in giving these colors an ad, you know, because Jimmy dropped the ball. I'm kidding, Jimmy. But anyway, here's the thing with Cam Newton. Here's the thing. They talk about, oh, Russell Wilson's most popular jersey. Here's the thing. Russell Wilson's not knocking him. He is who he is. But he's the safe Negro. He's the Negro they like. He's quiet. I'm not knocking the guy, you know. That's just who his personality is, you know. But he's the safe. We all know the safe Negro they like. They don't like the black man who is unapologetically black and unapologetically about his people. Not saying Russell is. I'm just using as an example how people prop him up. But the problem is, when Cam, let's just be real here, let's be honest here, guys. Aaron Rodgers doing pelvic thrusts, and he hadn't made one last time he made a good playoff run. And he's doing pelvic thrusts like he DX on wrestling. But he got commercials and millions of dollars off of that.
He got a whole commercial campaign off of it. I mean, you know, there's so many different ways you can go with this this analysis and this story. We can literally do a whole show on it. But the fact of the matter is, I mean, we all knew that it was already like this, but by him making the Super Bowl, it just, like, put the spotlight on him. And we all knew this was going to happen. It's not surprising.
I tell you this, white people really going to be mad when Jameis Winston becomes good, and it's twice a year Cam versus Jameis. They really going to be mad. It's going to be DEFCON 5 for those people.
Here's when they're really going to get mad, in about 10 to 15 years when none of them are at that position anymore, because that's one of the last things they holding on to. I mean, we coming for kickers too, so I'm just letting y'all know right now, you know what I'm saying, the kickers are coming.
and you know what the problem is, though, and see, this guy has done, and he ain't, you know, the Cam don't catch him giving balls to kids. And that was a story that came out where he just randomly gave a game touchdown ball to a kid, and the kid lost his father because his father was ill. And the father would take him to a Panthers game. That happened to be the game he went to, and gave him a ball. You know, show him to these people parties and stuff unannounced. You know, cell phone cameras catching him. So this guy does a lot for his community, a lot for these kids. Never get in trouble with the law, even though he should have got that stripper pregnant and marrying her. That's a whole different show.
Hey, listen, man. These strippers got some amazing – no, man, go ahead.
Hey, that's probably why he went to Auburn instead of Alabama. But anyway, you know, but the problem is, all jokes aside, the guy's a model citizen, a great quarterback who has grown up before our eyes and actually changed the culture of that team and actually changed the face of the NFL because the guy has fun. You know, the guy's out there having a good time. That team will run through a wall for him. And I'm like, if you don't like him celebrating, get mad at the guys who get a celebrating for a first down or making a tackle or a sack. Get mad at those people. You know, but Cam's an easy target.
Yeah, I mean, that's obvious. See, they're not the face of the organization. They're not as this is part. Heavy is the head that wears the crown. I mentioned it on several shows because I'm kind of prophetic. Talking about these bullets that he would have to take for all those coming behind him, like a Jameis Winston. Like damn near every quarterback in the SEC outside of your school who doesn't want to put a black man at quarterback. But that's either here nor there. You know, so the thing is, Cam is going through this, so other like Cam got to die for others to live, man. Like,
gotta
you know what I'm saying?
Him.
You know, it is what it is, man, yo. But, you know, we gonna dig deep into this, man.
Man, we appreciate your call, Tobias.
Thanks for the call.
Hey, no problem. And the Bulls still stink, by the way, and I'm a fan. See, anyway.
No doubt. All right, homie.
Take
it easy. Man, that takes us right in. I can't wait. Bart Scott.
Yes.
Yeah, we got
yeah,
another call on the line if y'all want to get that out the way.
Oh, I think that's Rob calling from Cali. I know Rob got to say something about Cam Newton. Rob.
Yo, what's up, man? It's your boy Big Grant, a.k.a. Mr.
A.k.a.
you know what I'm saying, 75 degrees right now, a.k.a. you know what I'm saying, good weather means good yams, you know what I'm saying, hot all around, you know what I'm saying, always fresh, yams is always fresh. But anyway, man.
Rob, also known as 75 degrees.
Degrees right now.
What?
You ain't got no
Yo. Yo, but anyway, let's first of all, I want to talk a little trash to Duke fans, man. Yo, y'all are four of us left.
Yeah, you might see me all blue.
They might see
y'all
all blue.
Yo, y'all are four. Yeah, devil blue. You know what I'm saying? The devil is a liar. You know what I'm saying? Blue devils. Yo, y'all are four of the last five games, man. Y'all had the most black players I ever seen in the last 3 years in the whole freaking time y'all ever existed. Y'all still can't get to number one spot. Come on, man. All right. That's all I got to say. Oklahoma's a phony. You know what I'm saying? We're going to prove that a tournament. But anyways, hello?
We listening to your call. This is your time, brother. You got about 60 more seconds.
You going in right now. We ain't trying to stop you. You know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? AKA 75 degrees right now. Let's have it.
AKA clean, fresh yams.
Clean. my yams stay clean, man. I clean them myself.
You,
anyways, now I cook them myself.
Wait, what? You got yams? I always thought you was a dude.
Go ahead, Rob. What you got to say about this Cam Newton controversy?
Talk about Cam. What's up? Now I know you got something to say about Cam. Cam Newton, I got mixed feelings. I think most of these people who are talking about Cam Newton to me are not traditional sports fans. We have to understand that football is bigger than ever been, and the average bandwagon dude can float for any team. They don't watch or have the knowledge of the game of sports the way that the average fan would be. Okay. We'll go all the way back to the 70s with the USFL. They had excessive celebrations too. We'll fight with two or three or more people. You know, and that was all throughout the South. So the people who are saying on Twitter or saying on Facebook or mailing letters, they're not the average sports fan. They're just, to me, just belligerent people who just want to find some excuse to be racist or excuse to hate on a brother. You know what I'm saying? You know, so that's all I got to say. The Super Bowl, first of all, I think Peyton Manning, is, for me, my childhood, yo, this dude was one of the best quarterbacks ever of all time. I always say the best quarterback ever, you know. Five MVPs. He broke NFL records two times. Two times, you know what I'm saying? Like, come on, Brady went and broke his record. He broke Brady's record, you know?
Well, that's what's up. You don't have to make a prediction yet, though, because look, we actually got two more.
We got a whole week, doggy.
Man. We got next week, and then the Saturday before the game, we're gonna have our annual hour special. So you got two more opportunities to think about it. You can call in with your prediction next week, and we'll get it going from there.
Man, I don't even want a prediction, dude. I just want to have a great game, dude. I just want to have a great Super Bowl. You know, I think Cam Newton, and people understand why I said Cam Newton's changing the game of football, because, to be honest, the offense that they run, to me, is relative to the offense that or should have been the offense that Michael Vick did in 2004 when he had T.J. Duckett, Warwick Dunn. Except the thing about Cam is Cam
Vick to come to practice, though.
Mike Vick can't do what Cam can do, though.
Mike Vick didn't come to practice nor read his playbook. I mean –
I don't think Cam is changing the game. I think Cam is a very athletic dude, and he's learning how to play quarterback. I don't think he's changing.
I think that Mike Vick, admittedly, I'm not even making this up. Mike Vick himself said he didn't read his playbook, he didn't study, and he barely went to practice. I mean,
he went out on the field.
We talk about practice
now. A couple pebbles, like, this going to be you. You do this, and I'm going to do this. Like,
Mike Vick, how you going to come out and say, I mean, he was being honest, though. He said when he was younger and in his prime in terms of being an athlete, he didn't work hard at the position. So, you know, that's the difference right there. You can tell that Cam is progressing and getting better, and at least he's putting forth the effort. That's one thing we can say that separates him from a Mike Vick and a lot of other people I can name. But with that being said, though, Rob, thanks for the call, good brother. Thanks for the support, as always, man. Keep the Facebook post coming. You know, maybe you need to check your spelling a little bit, but, you know, that's either here nor there. But salute, Rob.
Yo.
Salute.
Yo, man, take care, man. 75 degrees, man. I got to get some yes. Peace.
All right. Hey, 75 degrees. He is also known as 75 degrees.
He's also
known as Clean Yams. I was going to say.
That's the homie Rob. But anyway, man.
Right, so let's talk about this.
I mean,
this thing
callers,
itself.
Let's go.
Yeah, we let all the callers get theirs off. All right, Cam Newton. Look, man. It seems like he's become the new target of racism in America. He seems like he's the most hated man, at least the most hated black man in America. And I'm including Barack Obama in this. Like the stuff that we've seen lately on the internet, on social media directed towards Cam Newton, it's getting out of hand kind of. So what is the take that you guys have on this whole thing?
Well,
I love sports. And I think that this topic is a part of the reason why the War Room was created. You know, this is a study in American society and where we are. First of all, we'll look at the quarterback position being it's a position of leadership, and it has symbolic significance in our society. The quarterback is the leader of a 53-man unit of superhuman athletes that everybody looks to for their entertainment. Everybody looks to for their sadly their hopes and dreams, because we all know that these people, there's too much placed on them as role models and all of that type of stuff. So we know what the quarterback position means. For years and years and years, it was said that we, or black people, couldn't play that position because we lacked the mental capacity. So fast forward to 2016, when you look at the landscape of America and you see all of the racial tension and strifes and the representations and manifestations of white supremacy, white entitlement, white privilege, you see all of that going on in law enforcement, in everyday life, and then we come to sports and you see Cam as a tall, strapping, paused, young black man who unapologetically embraces being black, being a part of hip hop culture, being young, being a part of this generation. And he is positive because you don't really have much of the off-the-field stuff going on with Cam. It's almost like people – there's a segment of our population that nitpicks to find something wrong with him because they're uncomfortable with him as a representation of black masculinity. And you listen to the language that's being used to describe him by certain people in our American society, thug. Well, we know what the definition of a thug is. We know that that's, to some extent, someone involved in criminal activity. He's not involved in any criminal activity.
Oh, B, thug.
Yeah.
From what Jimmy showed me last week on Twitter, he might as well change his name to nigger.
Yeah. Like, well, it's going down a line. It's thug. It's criminal. It's nigger. It's all of these negative words that really don't fit his actions, because even with the celebrations, he includes the youth and the children. So that's a part of the redeeming. One of the redemption pieces is it seems like there's a lot of white people that have a problem or issue with him. But when you look at who he's handing balls, who he celebrates with at these games, unfortunately, because a lot of our folks aren't at the games that close to the field, he's handing these balls to young white kids and gaining fans amongst young. I think that also makes them uncomfortable.
Yo, man, first off, man, shout out to the one young black dude who's there every week, because it's one black dude who's there every week, but he never gets the football, man. But I see you, though.
That is one thing, though. Hey, Jim, do you think Cam, because I know what you're saying right now, do you think Cam goes out of his way to give the balls to little white kids just to kind of, you know, to quell some of the criticism? Because
I think part of it would be up and said, yo, it's like they like 12 to 1 there. I'll tell you the dudes during the games, when we talking during the games, I'm like, I wonder if the Panthers have, like, raised the prices in the end zones because – you know, he made that thing popular. You see him running down. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, salute the camp for changing the economics of the Panther Stadium. But this whole thing, once he went to the bowl, we knew this was going to come. We just, you know, sometimes you just still get upset when you see just how nasty it is. But before I dig deep, I do want to read a statement from Facebook by Brother Lamont. He says, what is it with America's insistence that talented people at the top of the profession, and that transcend said profession, have to be humble on an otherworldly scale? We as the public push them into trumped up positions of prominence amongst us, and then when they have the audacity to acknowledge it themselves, they're pegged as arrogant and flashy.
But they pick and choose. They pick and choose who they force to be humble too. That's not an always thing. They pick and choose.
Yeah, I mean, it's the automatic thing to go to that he's cocky or whatever. I mean, LeBron James said it that Cam Newton does more in the community than any athlete that he knows. I mean, that could be LeBron just giving him a blumpkin because he loves to, be humble.
Yeah, LeBron just want to jump in on every situation and get some attention on it.
No, he's like, yo, Jay-Z.
He said this in the beginning of the season.
Up and coming MC is hot. Jay-Z gonna jump on the track with him. He told LeBron
thing. That's kept him relevant for years. So that's a new marketing plan. You know what I mean, the humble marketing plan. But with that being said,
Koloff plan.
With that being said, the Koloff plan.
Dikita Koloff's humble plan. Humble marketing.
Some of this vitriol is just like out of control. I mean, you know, I think, and me and B. Austin have argued all season that in terms of how Cam is progressing and whether he looks better or not or what have you. But the fact of the matter is, he doesn't deserve this. I mean, it's kind of dominating. It's kind of dominating to talk about like an amazing season that him and his team
narrative.
Have had.
It's the entire narrative.
And it doesn't hurt the narrative that he's going against Peyton Manning, who's everyone's darling. You know what I'm saying? He cheats
and
does drugs, but
and is white. And is white.
He's Lily White. You know what I'm saying? He's Lily White. You know,
he represents their idea of what a white quarterback should be: tall, 6'5", highly intelligent, and making plays from the pocket, thinking the game through, all of that stuff that goes against. Or is the antithesis of what Cam Newton is thought to be. So that's the narrative, man.
This all deals with human beings, man.
I love sports.
Here's what this really boils down to, B. Austin. It boils down to the fact that white people have recessive genes, right? That's what this all boils down to. The reason why racism exists in general is because they're afraid of us. They're afraid, their fear of a black planet, in the words of Chuck D, because they know that just, you know, as time goes on and through sex and procreation, we can erase their entire yamin. So this is actually what's happening in
those
football.
Those are the views of one Jimmy Williams. That is not necessarily the views of War Room Sports or any of its other hosts or on-air personalities.
This is what's happening in football now. That position, when you look at it, is kind of being dominated on the lower levels by African Americans, because anytime we get an opportunity to do anything, and specifically within the arts, we dominate. That's what we do. It's the melanin in our system.
Yeah.
We can't help it. I mean, melanin helps us do these things. Like, it's superpower.
I don't know if I would say it's being dominated. We got two good ones.
No. I'm not talking about the NFL.
I'm talking about high school and college.
We've been doing that. They're few and
we just
far,
need a few more to
between.
Slip through the cracks and be able to do it on the higher level.
What I'm saying, Dev, is all that's going to be coming up to the highest level will be that. There's going to be no choice because there's not too many of them coming up. Rest in peace to Dr. Francis Cress Wilson, because this is kind of her theory in terms of the whole genetic thing. But this is basically what's happening at the quarterback position. I wasn't speaking of the pros, but when you look at high school, especially the dominant high schools, and when you look at college at the highest level, there's a lot of African-American quarterbacks there. And, you know, it's a situation where eventually, as time goes on, we're going to dominate this position. And they see that. So
I know, but
it's kind of
but
like,
then,
you know,
still, you know the deal, because you speak on it all the time as well, though. We're still being unfairly taught at that age, though. So
this is true.
That's
why
a lot of the domination
theory,
is going on the high school and the college.
But my theory, though, is
they're not teaching those kids like they're teaching those other kids.
My
theory on that is the pro game is going to kind of like shape itself to look more like – it's already happening. The pro game is going to look more collegiate and more high school. The game is going to change. That's how it's going to be played at every level, because the fact of the matter is what people are able to do from an athletic standpoint is amazing. So coaches, this is what they do. This is what they coach. So my theory is the pro game will kind of reflect what's happening at high school, what's happening in college. And that's going to change.
I hope that they just teach, you know, our kids the way they teach those other kids. Because if you look at a Cam Newton, you look at a Russell Wilson, they're starting to learn how to play the position at a pro
from the
level.
Pocket.
The problem is with like a Cam versus other number one picks, those guys come in knowing how to play the position at a pro level. Cam came in and you can tell has worked his ass off to become better at his craft, and it's paying off, you know, day by day, week by week. But let me get – I know you guys probably heard this because the video was floating around. I think we shared it as well. Ryan Clark, who's an analyst now for the Four Letters, he had a take on the situation, and he was saying that it's not racism. He said these problems with Cam, the issues with Cam – is resulting from a culture issue. He named black quarterbacks of the past, Randall Cunningham, Warren Moon, guys like that, and said, you know, they all had to conform to what the expectation of a professional quarterback was. You know, the divas are the wide receivers. They're the celebrating guys and the cornerbacks and people like that. But you're not used to seeing that at the quarterback position. And because Cam isn't willing to change, and he's a part of this hip-hop culture, that's the reason why a lot of people dislike him. Now, I thought Ryan – what did I call him before?
Ryan Clark.
I might have called him Grant by mistake. But Ryan Clark, I thought he made some really good points, but I don't think he's speaking for all of the quote-unquote hatred that Cam has been getting.
I can
understand his point in a lot of cases. Okay, all right, quarterbacks, we're not used to seeing quarterbacks dancing. You know, quarterbacks aren't supposed to act like that, yada, yada, yada. But if he saw some of the stuff that we saw on the internet, it could be nothing but rooted in racism racist epithets were just flying. Like, out of control.
Yeah.
Also, one thing I want to say is this, though. I want to say that in terms of like how African Americans play quarterback and how they're taught to play quarterback, I think part of it is opportunity as well, because 96% of quarterbacks stink. I just made that percentage up, by the way. 96% of quarterbacks stink, regardless of what race they are. But the fact of the matter is, we don't get the opportunities. But if we got the same level of opportunities, I think that we would have the same level of successful quarterbacks. When you look at the great quarterbacks, most of them aren't African-American because we just didn't get the opportunity to play that position because of what B. Austin has said in reference to it being a position of leadership, how that position is looked at or what
taught,
have you.
How it's so, taught.
But even in how it's taught, like Devin said that Cam Newton and Russell Wilson are learning to play the position, I think that more guys would if more guys had the opportunity, which goes to my theory of change is coming. So they better get mad.
I just think it's unfortunate that they can't, you know, they're really not learning to play it until they get to the professional range. I mean, our athleticism and what we can do with the arm talent.
Even in that, though, because a lot of that is rooted in racism, too, because it's funny. I was talking to Austin during the Chiefs game, and they were showing, like, the statistics of Alex Smith, who has more rushing yards than most black quarterbacks in the league. And I'm like, it's funny. They never call him a rushing quarterback or say he's run first or he plays the game this way. He doesn't get that.
That's true.
You know what I'm saying? So it's a lot of that, too. B-Off, I know you got a point to make. A homie, Mont, who I just read his Facebook post, he actually called in. He got some more bars.
We're going to grab Mont in a second. I just wanted to address what Dev was saying with regards to Ryan Clark. Yo, salute to Ryan Clark. We invite you on the show to have some dialogue. Hopefully you'll take us up on that. Because I really respect the way he articulated his points and the perspective he gave. I think that he made some very, very valuable points, but I do think that his perspective is limited from the place or position that he's A, fresh out of the NFL. So he's just recently retired. So he knows all of these guys. He's also a member of a certain niche and segment of the media, and he's gaining his insight from that limited vantage point that's outside of the realm of the casual fan that we know consumes the NFL, particularly a story as large as Cam. So when he speaks, I think he speaks of, okay, guys in the locker room. He even used guys in the locker room as an example because he was saying one of their wives, white guy, white quarterback, one of the wives said, I just don't like him. I don't know why. I don't know why I don't like his antics. I don't know why I just don't like it. So I think that his perspective comes from the players and from the media as opposed to the common man. And I think if he stepped outside of that, he would see that there is a white supremacist undertone to the group of people who don't like Cam. Even the group that go beyond saying I don't have an issue with him. There's a group of people that say, well, there is no racial issue. Why are you bringing it up? There's that group of people. So there's a number of folks that are involved in this, that have a stakehold in this, that watch football, that participate, that enjoy this, that really have an issue with this young man, and it goes beyond him and beyond what he's doing on the field to masculinity.
And then you have guys like Charles Barkley who said he just doesn't want to hear about it at all. Like, he doesn't want to hear about race. Then, of course, the Super Bowl. I don't know what country or world he lives in. You know, it's like
in Berkeley
certain
land,
certain athletes and entertainers, like they get put in a position, you know, based upon economics where and also fame, where they can't relate to the average guy. Like if Charles Barkley was still living in Alabama and had never had the success he had, I guarantee you his viewpoint would be different. They kind
of
forget what it's like.
Jimmy, he's $100 million away from where he started, and that rearview mirror is small as ish. He can't.
Yeah, but sometimes they forget where they come from. They forget what it's like to be on the other side, you know. But even those who act like that, eventually they get humbled. Shout out to Cosby. Yo, let's get the homie Mont on the line. Mont wants to call in and you know, drop some more bars about this topic. Mont, what's
going on,
brother?
What's going on,
how
you?
Man, what up, Mont? You in the war room.
That's what's up. I'm doing well. So I think this issue is twofold, and they kind of relate to each other. I think one is the obvious racial undertones that are here, right? So for so long,
white America has held every other ethnicity in check as far as acknowledging their greatness. And it's become so prevalent that we've woven it into the fabric of American culture that you have to be humble all the time, because God forbid anyone that's good at anything say that they're good at it. So we've woven that into American culture, and the real reason is because we can't, as American, white Americans cannot admit to anyone else that they are really, really or exceptionally good at something. You look at all these athletes that are talented and gifted and dominate sports on athleticism alone, and that's where the fear is, because if they ever learn the game the same way that their white counterparts would with that talent, they would dominate and completely shut you white people out. I mean, if you look at Serena and Venus Williams, their dominance, according to the media, over the past decade and a half has been surely by feats of their athletic ability alone. It has nothing to do with how they play the game of tennis, in which they're just completely dominant. It's all about their athleticism, and they won't acknowledge greatness anywhere else or in anything. So as a culture, America says, suppress anything that's great and be humble. And that's what sports is in America right now. You have it with little league games. Little kids can't hot dog. You can't backhand the ball instead of running around and catching it underhand. You can't one hand catch a pass if you can do it. Why not? If I'm great, let me be great.
Don't overscore. Don't score too many points.
Yeah. What is that? I mean, it's so bad that they accuse the president of the United States of being an elitist. If the president of the United States of the free world isn't an elitist, who the hell should be? It don't make any damn sense. He's the ultimate elitist.
Because I'm a damn nobody, and I'm an elitist. So what the hell?
Exactly. I don't want no bum-ass president. No regular Joe. Get out of here. He's supposed to be above me. It's craziness. It is absolutely crazy. I'm going to let y'all talk on this and get off your show.
All right,
man.
Thank you.
Bob, we appreciate
that.
That's a good-ass point, though, man.
Like, who was the president like when you talking to him, you trying to look him in his eye and he got his head down because he feels intimidated by you.
Humble.
Yo, it was a great book written. I can't remember the name of the book. But as a matter of fact, that the lady was at Temple that year on the panel. She wrote a baseball book, and the whole book, she literally like combed through film of baseball for like 10 years and looked at how they talked about the elite black players and Mexican players versus the white players. And literally went through each part of the film and look how they described them, how all the black guys were athletic and, you know, they, you know, were fast and strong. And then all the white players were supremely intelligent and smart and played the game the right way. She literally
I wrote a blog about that one time. That might end up in the infamous book.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah. And it's crazy because, like, that's kind of like, you know, what Mon just alluded to. And it also goes to my point. It's the fear. It's the fear of us dominating that position. So and that's the thing that people don't understand. Most of racism is rooted in fear.
Right.
People think, well,
right,
they think they're better than racism. Right. Is rooted in fear. That's what it is. It's fear.
Yeah.
Because
very valid point.
You know, like most people who don't have like the fear of another race or people that, you know, I don't fear that so FOH. But at the same time, I understand what racism is rooted in. So this whole thing is amazing.
To your fear of black balls. Shout out to Martin.
Exactly. Shout out to Martin. He had it right there.
No, to your point, Jimmy. And what do people fear most? They fear the unknown. And if you look at the racial divide in this country and where the people come from that have a problem with Cam, their only interaction with black culture is what they are fed through the media and what they consume on social media and in entertainment. So they don't know. So that's what they're afraid of. Oh, my God. Here they come.
People fear what they can't understand, hate what they can't conquer. Shout out to Nas.
Yo, Nasir Jones, the great poet. But it's the truth, though, man. This whole thing is rooted in fear. So I just laugh at them. And some of them really have no clue. And it's almost to the point now, because race has like been a topic over the last several years, and people are really being called to the carpet. Now they feel like they're the ones that are, you know, pretty much being oppressed.
They feel oppressed.
They're trying to flip the script.
You're taking my white privilege away.
The crazy thing. about the whole Cam Newton thing, Jim, though, is that, you know, he's become such a polarizing figure that everybody on the other side of the spectrum have done their best the last few days to drown out the negative. Because, you know, the things that we dug up on social media maybe in the middle of the week or last week, man, if you go to Twitter right now and just put in Cam Newton's name and you get all the tweets about him, like, you can't even find the negative anymore because now it's one big Blumpkin fest about
because
Cam Newton
saying,
because everybody
is,
basically came to
it's not
defense.
Me. I'm not like that. That's what they're going right now.
Oh, you're talking about that. That. Yeah, you do have.
Yeah, so everybody's going out of their way. It might be some guilty consciences out there because now everybody's going out of their way to praise Cam Newton. I know a lot of those people were, you know, the draft pundits that said he was, you know, too stupid to be a quarterback and all that kind of stuff. I'm not going to fry. I didn't first.
And I agree with him.
Success. You know, I didn't think he was going to be that great of a quarterback. And, you know, he still has stuff to prove to me. If he can duplicate this year.
He still threw the ball to Brother Malcolm
like
3 times.
If he can duplicate this year, then, you know, it's nothing that anybody's going to be able to say. But he's good, and he's going to stick around. Greatness is
but
probably
here's my thing,
still
man.
On the table
I'm
right
total,
now. He's definitely a superstar.
I'm a total opposite of Charles Barkley. He doesn't want to hear it, but to me, this gives us another opportunity once again to have these conversations.
Yeah,
and I don't mind. I don't mind Yakubians who like just basically will be honest. As long as you're being honest and we can have a dialogue. But when they try to shut you down and act like this isn't happening, this is made up. That's what I don't like.
Yeah,
I'm like,
that's the biggest.
I'm like, come on, like, let's have the conversation.
You know what, Jimmy? That's the most dangerous part of all of this. It's not those white folks that are spewing forth the word nigger. It's not those white folks that are calling him a thug or a criminal or overly, you know, zealous in their hating of Cam and what he represents. That's easy enough to deal with because you can have that dialogue. It's those that feel like the quarterback's wife that Ryan Clark had the conversation with, I don't know why. And they keep it to themselves because they feel ashamed of that feeling they have. Those are the most dangerous because they're the people that keep the country where it is. They don't want to acknowledge, so you can't have the discussion. You can't work on a problem that you don't acknowledge. And that's why America is such a powder keg right now, because for generations we've ignored it. We've acted like it isn't here. And now, guess what? It's here.
And B,
yeah,
I know we got to move on.
And I'm still rooting for Cam Newton. I'm still rooting for Peyton Manning to bring home this Super Bowl.
But listen, B, to add to what you just said about, you know, that dangerous set of people, there's another dangerous set of folks as well. The people, and they prevent the conversation as well. It's the people who,
the black,
you know, claim to have no problem with certain people, but refuse to come out of their little box because they're cool with them. They don't see, you know, anybody else having a problem with the person. You know what I'm saying? You got to go outside of your box a little bit. Just because you're fine with the guy and you're a fan of the guy doesn't mean that this stuff isn't going on. So the conversation still must be had.
First of all, I just want to say, man, like this has kind of put me in the best spot because anyone knows that I'm very pro-black. Doesn't mean I'm anti-white. It just means I'm pro-black. I'm like one step away from Craig Hodges, but it just puts me in the best spot for the second time in my life, man. Because the two times we've had an African American quarterback who was a polarizing figure playing in the Super Bowl, they had to go against my Broncos, man. I'm like, damn, I can't catch a break. Because my Broncos weren't playing, I'd be all out rooting for Cam, but I can't because I'm a Broncos fan. Let's go.
Yo, how ironic is that, Jimmy? Actually,
it's the football guy trying to mess with me, though.
Except for Kaepernick, every black quarterback who's ever made the Super Bowl was playing against your team.
Damn.
Doug
Williams. No, I just thought about that.
Russell Wilson. Of the week.
Cam Newton.
Yeah,
I mean,
man, it's the football guys being
like
nasty to me, man.
Like Kaepernick.
Yeah, you're off the chain. But
that's ironic,
I think Kaepernick is. I don't think Russell is, though. I think the football guys are being, you know, they don't like some of my commentary on this podcast, and they know how ignorant I am.
So they're going to test you.
And they also know how pro-black I am. They want to test me. They want to test me.
They
want to test me.
They were like, you still on that Nat Turner? All right. Let's see your Broncos go against this guy. Who are you going to root for next?
Yo. Yeah, man. So I just think this gives us a chance to have the conversation, which is amazing. And a salute to my people, my white folks who are willing to have the conversation and also willing to be open-minded, because I have talked to people who are willing to be open-minded, hear my thoughts on it, my opinions, and give me their thoughts and their opinions. And there's nothing better than having an open dialogue. Like, I'm not one of these people, which I find online all the time. If someone disagrees with you, then you just go all out and it becomes nasty and you want to fight. I never get that. I mean, I disagree with like Devin B. Austin daily, but I mean, those are my brothers. There's nothing wrong with disagreeing with someone. You're not going to agree on everything. But the fact of the matter is, sometimes when I disagree with someone, I want them to try to give me their opinion and tell me why they think the way they think, because it might open my mind up. You never know. Right. So I'm all about having a conversation, and this is why sports is beautiful, because Cam Newton gives us an opportunity to have these conversations that we otherwise wouldn't be having. We wouldn't be having this if it was the Cardinals in the Super Bowl. You know what I mean?
Yeah. That's the most difficult thing in the world, though, when you're discussing something with someone who's not even at least going to open their mind to hear what you're trying to say. But that's something else. All right, so look, man, let's give our stat of the week, because, you know, like I said, we got two other episodes where I'm sure some more stuff is going to come up about this, and we will be on it. Hopefully we'll get on War Room Sports TV and talk our ish for the next 2 weeks before Super Bowl 50 as well. Well, let's take somebody from one of the losing teams from the conference championships. Like, when we found this stat, it was so amazing that even though he was on the losing end, we still had to bring it up. Like, Larry Fitzgerald, we talk about wide receivers all the time. We talk about drops a lot, probably because, you know, most of us are Eagles fans and all of us are from Philly, so we don't have a choice but to talk about drops. we watch some of the great receivers, you know, drop passes and do more off their athleticism. And finally, we watch Ted Ginn Jr. every week, and we're going to watch him again in the Super Bowl. That brings us to Larry Fitzgerald's hands. And he had a commercial one time. I forgot what the commercial was about, but the dude hollered, "Good hands, Larry. It's nice hands, Larry." Something like that. And we watch him and we marvel at his hands. We always have for 12 years. But we just didn't realize how great his hands really were, because we know as one of the top receivers in the league during his 12 years, he gets a lot of targets. However, this dude has 24 drop passes in his entire career. 12-year career, that's an average of 2 drop passes per season.
That's crazy. Yo, I don't think people understand how crazy that is.
Mike Evans, Mike Evans is considered a top 10 to 15 receiver in the league right now, and I've watched him drop 8 passes in a game.
Hold on, though, real and quick, Be Austin and Dev, I got to say something to both of y'all, man, because I found this hilarious. The brother PJ just sent me a text and said that we also forgot McNabb played in the bowl, too. How are y'all Eagles fans and forget that McNabb is a black quarterback that played in the bowl and didn't play the Broncos?
Because he threw the ball to the other team 3-4 times and he threw up. He's a coward.
Seriously, as fans, though, we be trying to erase that game from our memory, man.
I'm a coward. He forgot McNabb play. Anyway, back to Fitz, though.
Yo, we traded him with Stacey Dash. We traded
yo,
him.
Yo, the crazy part is, like,
I
in
traded
2000,
him.
Three-way trade.
In
McNabb, Dash, and Tiger.
Larry Fitzgerald literally has 0 drops. He has 2 seasons, but he didn't have a drop at all. 07 and 2014, he has 0 drops. My man had 1 drop. Well, actually, this past season, including the first playoff game, this was leading up to last week, where I don't know what happened to him, but he had a couple drops. But he had 1 drop leading into the NFC Championship. Yeah. But his numbers are crazy.
In 2006, he had the drop season. He had 5 whole drops in 2006. Yo, I've seen T.O. drop 5 passes in the game, and for me, T.O. is like top 2 or 3 of all time.
T.O. to me is maybe top 5 of all time, and he can't catch.
He can't catch.
Yeah, so I actually wish we had that sound. Nice hands, Larry. That's a crazy
thing. Speaking of that, though, here's my next question to you, because before that game, I was like, you know, I couldn't believe how he played leading up to the NFC Championship and how he took one of those limitless pills and took over the game.
At that point, I'm thinking Fitz might be top five all time, specifically looking at the amount of drops he has, his production, how he plays in big games up until last week. Where do you guys rank Fitz?
Nah, not definitely not top five. I think you're out of your mind.
Maybe 10, top, 12.
Top 15. He's definitely top 20. Top 15.
Damn, 20?
I can name 10.
Beyonce be like in dudes like Ricky Pro or whatnot, so I can't.
No. It's not even about that. It's go ahead, Death.
Fitz Gerald was, for a good portion of his career, he was a victim of circumstance. You know, we always say wide receiver is the most dependent position, maybe in sports, not just in the NFL. And he was dependent on nobody. You know, once he lost Kurt Warner, he went through a gamut of bum-ass quarterbacks. And he had pretty good years for, like, an average receiver. But this is Fitzgerald. So I think, you know, a lot of people thought he was washed until Carson Palmer came. And it showed that our theory was correct. Like, it's just a dependent position. If you don't have anybody to throw to you, it doesn't matter how good of a wide receiver.
Yeah, but you know what, though? It's like, there are guys like Jerry Rice, Randy Moss, and T.O., who I got, like, at the top of the food chain. But even within that, when Randy Moss had to play with some bum-ass quarterbacks, he wasn't productive at all.
That's just because he didn't want to be.
Circumstances.
But what I'm saying is, T.O. had years where he played with bum-ass quarterbacks. He wasn't productive either. But it's like, I can't, outside of those three, I can't really name somebody that's like head and shoulders above Fitzgerald.
Well, that's the thing, Jimmy. I don't want you to subscribe to casual fan logic. The difference in actual skill or ability or talent or where you rank between number 5 and number 15 is minuscule. Yeah, at the top of the mountain, it ain't that much different. So it's not a knock to me to be in the top 20.
I'm not saying you're knocking him at all. No, I'm not saying you're knocking him at all. And I agree with the fact that you could be in a top 20. That's still an amazing. I mean, it's written about in Sports the Book, which you can get at sportsthebook.com. But what I'm saying is, like, who else would you have ahead of him?
I know. Let me give you an example. I know for a fact that when Larry Fitzgerald came to town during that time when we were considering him, quote unquote, washed up, because I was with you, Dev. I believe that as well. When we considered him washed up, teams weren't rolling coverage over him. Teams were scared of Larry.
I didn't think he was washed up. I was just saying, he ain't got no quarterback.
I knew he didn't have a quarterback, but I thought maybe he had slowed down. I still might think that he slowed down, but slowing down athletically doesn't mean that you lose the ability to dominate, which he shows. I mean, dude's not fast, and he doesn't need to be. But I think that when you look at him, the guys that you named, Jimmy, people don't come in and say, okay, here, you got cornerback, lock him down. Guys say whole secondary.
The whole time in Oakland. And the whole time in Oakland, Moss never got doubled in Oakland. Like, there's a whole time that when – that's my point. My point is when Moss played with some starry quarterbacks, he got the same treatment. It's not relegated just to Larry Fitzgerald. I'm just saying, give me some names of who you would put up there. Just give me a couple names. That's all I want to know.
Marvin Harrison, definitely Torrey Holt.
I'm taking him over Torrey Holt.
You taking him over? Yeah, I mean that's fair. I mean,
as long as you don't say Ricky Pro. If you say Ricky Pro, I'm leaving the show. You can't
like maybe Moss, T.O., Jerry Rice, Marvin Harrison,
I'll give you those three.
Tim Brown, Michael Irvin, maybe like a. I don't like to really speak too much on dudes that played before my time, but a Len Swan.
Tim Brown is overrated, by the way.
Nah, I'm not taking Len Swan. I ain't taking Len over him.
Tim Brown is overrated. Len Swan is also overrated.
Yeah.
But I can't hear nor there, man. All right, man, let's move on, though. I just had to ask that question, man.
He might make me. I just want to make sure. Dwarf Len Swan, so yeah. I give y'all that.
Yeah.
I mean, Len Swan had like 336
catches. Right now, your stats will – Yeah, come on, man. Len Swan is – he played on a great team, so his name gets mentioned, but he wasn't built like that.
Yeah, Len Swan is – I'm not even saying he wasn't built like that. I'm just looking at the era he played in. He didn't even have enough opportunity to compare with some of these other guys Like I can't.
And he made a couple beautiful catches on big stages, but at the end of the day, man, like yo, he ain't cut from that cloth. He ain't no special cloth type wide receiver. Anyway, man. Let's move on, man, because we definitely got to get some basketball talk in, man. And for those who don't know, the NBA Wrap is brought to you by Fanatics for the best in your favorite team's merchandise. Here's what you do. Go to warroomsports.com and get you some gear from Fanatics. You can get NFL, NBA, NHL, MLB, and NCAA gear. I don't know if they have any Ricky Pearl jerseys, but you definitely can get you a Cam Newton jersey. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to all y'all out there hating Cam. Go cop a jersey. Warroomsports.com. Click on that Fanatics logo. And, you know, get you a nice little Cam Newton jersey, man. It's time to talk basketball, gentlemen.
Probably already got Cam jersey. He's faking. So they won't look like they traded.
They like burning them and whatnot. Yo, the NBA players of the week are my man Boogie, DeMarcus Cousins, and Kemba, no relation to Samaki Walker. Let's be all
fine. I hope there's no relation to Samaki.
Yo, Dev, what's their stats look like?
Yo, the Cousins averaged 36 points and almost 15 rebounds in 3 wins this past week. At the time, he had scored a career-best 48 points in a win over Indiana, but he came back a couple nights later this week and put up 56 on somebody. So his career highs, he's toppled that twice in 2 weeks. Kemba Walker, no relation to Samaki. He averaged 34.8 points, 6 rebounds, and 6 assists. The Hornets had a 3-1 week. He had a 52-point game in double overtime against the Jazz, and he had 40 against the Magic. So shout-out to those brothers. Balling, Kemba Walker. I think he's won it, like, twice this year, but he's a guy.
Yes, sir.
Kemba going in this year.
Yes, sir.
The Austin Cousin. He going in this year. I don't know what's wrong with him. I guess he's like, look, I'm just going to start gunning like I used to do back in college.
I need to get this. I need
Boogie,
to get this.
Boogie need contract.
Yo, Boogie need to get traded. And you know how he gets that done? You sign with Clutch
Sports. Go to Cleveland.
And let LeBron and them get you traded. Clutch Sports, they run the league. They strong arm the hell out of teams.
Clutch Sports is the state of silent partner with everybody. Everybody doesn't know. They're the Illuminati of the NBA. Yeah. Shot the
Clutch
Sports.
Sports is the mafia of the NBA.
Be Austin is funny, yo. Be Austin like anybody that guns. Be Austin like anybody that guns, yo. Kemba
yo,
on his
you
roster.
Win the game
Kemba
by
start,
scoring
Kemba start
points.
Gunning. Once Kemba start gunning, he start riding for Kemba.
Hey, you don't win the game it's by like, kissing Isaiah or passing the
yo,
ball. You win by scoring.
It's part of the reason why, like, yo, if LeBron start taking 30 shots a game, I think B. Austin might change his whole
LeBron already takes LeBron takes more shots per game than Kobe.
That's not what I said. Yeah. I said take 30 shots a game. I said nothing about taking more shots than Kobe.
Because Kobe is universally known as the definition.
No, you were just waiting to pull that stat out. I know you was, but I wasn't even listening. I said take 30
shots. Should have been stat of the week.
he was waiting to pull that one out the clip. All I'm saying is, if LeBron took 30 shots a game, be awesome like anybody that jacks the ball, man. So Kemba Walker is now on his roster
shooting
to a gun.
Yo, you shoot to win the game. You score. You score.
I mean, I hear you. We ain't going to get into this debate right now, but I hear you.
You score.
I hear you. Now, I hear you, man.
Points.
I hear you. I hear you, beloved. But anyway, man, getting back to Clutch Sports, who is the silent partner of everyone, man. David Blatt was fired and Tyronn Lue was hired. And pretty much everybody's holding LeBron responsible, whether that's true or not.
They're holding LeBron and his high basketball IQ responsible.
LeBron is the most successful player in the league right now.
Passive
outside of Kobe.
Strong
Kobe's half
champion
in the league
of the
anyway.
World, man.
Damn, my fault.
First of all,
Tim Duncan too.
David Blatt, and this is supported by, you know, a lot of insider articles, man. David Blatt never had a chance. If you guys recall, he was hired before LeBron James decided to come back. So, you know, his job was in jeopardy from the moment LeBron wrote that BS letter. And came back to Cleveland. It's crazy, but we just talked about Clutch Sports and how they're the mafia. The rumors are that the whole thing, LeBron wanted. Well, I'm sorry, Clutch Sports wanted Mark Jackson as the coach of the Cleveland Cavaliers. Signed him to Clutch Sports with the intentions of doing that. Cleveland management didn't budge on the, and this is real risky, you know, to say no to Clutch Sports. They didn't budge on the Mark Jackson thing, but they kind of gave them Tyronn Lue as a compromise because LeBron was like, okay, no David Blatt, but, you know, we like Tyronn Lue, so if we can't get Mark Jackson, we can at least get Tyronn Lue. Because I remember when it dropped earlier, you know, last week, and Jimmy, you were like, yo, not only is he taking David Blatt's place, but they signed the dude to like a 3-year contract. So
yeah, hooked him up.
Basically, his replacement was already in place. There's no interim. We're going to fire you and make your assistant your replacement for good 3-year contract. This is a crazy situation.
Yo,
the dude was like 69-21, made it to the NBA Finals. We know that's, you know, because he's coaching LeBron James. But still, how do you justify getting fired with that resume? He's also, you know, coached the team to a number one seed thus far this season. In the East, that's not hard to do. But when you got LeBron James on your team,
I'm going to tell you how
that's
possible. Here's how that's possible, Dev. It's possible because Blue Horseshoe loves Anacott Steele. And what I mean by that is LeBron James is Gordon Gekko. Like, mm-hmm. LeBron James is a power broker in his league. Cats don't realize, man, this is bigger than basketball, man. LeBron James got his foothold on this entire game and the entire industry. My man signed billion-dollar sneaker deals and then plays chess with people around the league while letting the Warriors win the championship. But that's either here or there, man.
because while the Warriors winning the championship, he understands that Stephen Curry is more marketable, and they got a deal going on behind the scenes. So, LeBron is – yo, he's Gordon Gekko, like you said. It's about making this
play. Yeah, man, he's Gordon Gekko, man. Yo, LeBron James is – he's a Gordon Gekko with the NBA, man.
He tried to get Spo fired. He said,
yo,
I don't want to work.
LeBron probably got a minority percentage in the Warriors.
Yo, but that is so crazy to me because you really couldn't find a justifiable reason to fire the dude. So getting blown out by the Warriors last week was the greatest thing that could happen to LeBron, Clutch Sports, and everybody else on the Cleveland Cavaliers because – first of all, I heard that even the nobodies on the team kind of disrespected David Blatt, but that's what you get when the top guy disrespects you in front of those guys. It gives them a license to basically act the same way. If you know LeBron's not banging with him, then you know his time and his tenure is going to be short there. So the 12th man on the bench can say what he wants to David Blatt because LeBron's already set the standard, you know? And that's basically how it went down. It's crazy.
When LeBron was thinking about coming back, they shouldn't have hired a coach before he came back. I mean, that's part of the thing. They shouldn't have done that. Because, and by the way, this all is Michael Jordan's fault, by the way, for those who don't know. This is all Michael Jordan's fault. because what LeBron has done is LeBron has recognized his power, and now he's using it and abusing it. And
LeBron
people,
like Spider-Man after he got bit by the spider.
Yeah. Like Jordan laid down the carpet, LeBron's walking on that carpet, and he's taking full advantage of all of it. Like, you know, so salute to him for recognizing his power as a brother, like pretty much running things. But at the same time, man, you know, it's a difference between being a boss and being a leader. Those are two different things. Now, y'all can write that down for those at home. Take some notes. Everybody wants to be a boss, but how many of y'all want to be leaders? Is LeBron being a great leader right now? I don't know. I mean, you know, it's subjective. Who knows? I mean,
a leader,
but it doesn't
a leader,
look that way.
I'd say
a
not.
Leader.
I'd say he's being a great boss, but not a leader.
A leader, the definition of a leader, and you guys can write this down for all of those listening. A leader.
He wants people to take notes when they listen.
Inspiration. You got to inspire. You have to sacrifice for others. You got to put others first. And you got to be able to minister to the needs of many as opposed to the few. LeBron is a boss.
So basically,
LeBron
you just described Magic Johnson.
Hey, and a good leader has to be able to follow as well, you know, when it calls for it. Good leader puts, you know, great people in position. So sometimes you have to take a step back and defer to the great people that you put in position. So.
And now you have just finished the War Room Sports Management class. So we letting you guys know the leader
notes.
Is out here today.
That's free.
Take notes.
We are not charging y'all by the credit.
And there will be some homework. But the bottom line is, man, that's my point.
Next
my point
time,
is
that's
this
a three-credit class.
There's a difference between being a boss and being a leader. And one of the definitions of a leader, in the words of Jim Collins, who wrote a powerful book, you got to put the right people on the bus. So with that being said, LeBron, you know, has a history of super teaming and is grabbing superstars. We know he didn't put the right person on the bus by recruiting Kevin Love there because he doesn't fit with what they're trying to do. So at this point, they're trying to do everything to kind of save this whole situation. And here's the problem I see with the whole
thing. They're
going
to get Boogie Cousins by the end of the season.
I'm thinking that, too. They're going to have to do something. And here's why. Because at this point, if you guys don't succeed, who else is there to blame? If you would have kept Blatt at least to the end of the season and y'all didn't get it done, you could have threw him under the bus in the offseason and then, you know, tried something else. But we know there's been one coach who's really gotten in LeBron's ish, so to speak, and that was Paul Silas, and he got him, you know, out of here as well. If you look at the coaches that he's played with, I'm shocked that he has two rings. My man played with Mike Brown when Mike Brown had zero experience. He's playing with Tyronn Lue, who had zero experience. Even in Miami, he played with the Bull when he had zero experience. Like, yo, he basically wants to be coach, it sounds like.
Yeah, I mean, but he, of course, he's denying that he had anything to do with it. And, you know, in his denial, you know, he showed off his arrogance. Like, and like Lamont said, like, there's no need to be humble if you're that damn good. LeBron was like, I mean, of course I'm going to have input. Like, I have a great basketball IQ. I have a lot to give. Like, he was just going in, like, praising himself. And you rarely hear that side of LeBron. Usually Kobe's the a-hole. He's so arrogant. He's a jerk. You know, you heard LeBron this time basically tell everybody how smart he is as a basketball guy. So he always had input, but he never disrespected the coach.
He said, well, stop questioning me and go back to your miserable lives.
Part of me likes evil LeBron, though. I'm not going front. Part of me thinks this is amazing and hilarious. Because at the end of the day, like I'm watching the Warriors just dismantle the league, so I don't even know if anybody can beat them in a 7-game series. But to see LeBron just go full Gordon Gekko is kind of amazing. And to see him talk about his IQ is hilarious. Like, I like evil LeBron. Like, stop fronting, man. Like, you know, it's like when he first got to Miami and the whole world turned on him, he kind of like, you know, like acted like real LeBron and dominated for a couple years. You know what I mean? Get back to being evil LeBron. Evil LeBron won championships. Once people start loving him again, guess what happened? You stop winning championships.
Yo, evil LeBron, Jimmy, you're losing sight of the goal here, man. He's about marketing and branding. He's a salesman. So evil LeBron can't sell. He can win, but he can't sell.
So it's a constant fight between winning
and
selling.
Evil,
so.
If he's evil, he's Kobe. But if he's selling out and smiling and playing behind the scenes, then he's Magic. You know who's winning out of that and who's going to touch him, Billy. Once Kobe's done, he's done. Ain't no money in
the Magic won five chips just like Kobe and going to touch him, Billy. So
yeah, but
Magic was able to
put that squad together. He had that big Muslim there.
Yeah, and I'm saying LeBron has been able to put the squad together too. I'm not commenting on that. LeBron has been able to put squads together too, so you can do both. But I like where you're going with that.
LeBron ain't putting squads together. LeBron has.
I like where you were going with that theory until you shared the Magic because
he had two stars.
Like a fiction book.
And that bench was consisting of us. Magic never had a bench that consisted of us.
I mean, that whole if you want to break down player for player, that whole thing with the Lakers bench being stacked is kind of overrated too.
I didn't say it was stacked. But LeBron had us on the bench because of free agency. He was dealing with different type of money back then. Well, go ahead.
He don't have us on the bench right now. You know what I'm saying? Like, LeBron has had teams. Man, this whole thing with LeBron not having teams, y'all got to chill with that. My whole point is this, though. I like that whole theory of LeBron struggling between making the Billy and winning championships. I like that. That's a pretty good thing. I'm going to expound on that in Infamous. But
yeah,
anyway,
right.
Man, there's more to talk about within the National Basketball Association, specifically Tyronn Lue. Like, salute to him for getting this job. One of the perks of this job, considering Cleveland's first in the East, is that he gets to coach the All-Star game, which is hilarious.
That's foul. That's foul right there, though. And I'm saying it's foul not because – I mean, because you're already past the point of no return. You can't put Blatt on the sideline. I mean, LeBron's going to be in the game, for God's sake. You can't put Blatt there. That's just an embarrassment for him. But you can't put Tyronn Lue there. Dude, like 2-1 as a coach. Even though he got more wins in his record than Luke Walton. And Luke Walton coached the team damn near to an undefeated record. But that's a whole other thing. But you can't do that. You can't. You have to just move on to the next coach. You have to move on to the next team, the next best team in the league, and put their coach there. I think it's ludicrous. I think it's a Travis Sham mockery to have Tyronn Lue on the bench for the All Star game. You know,
come on,
naming
man.
Him
you
that
know, you know who Tyronn Lue is, Brett Barr? It's that Clutch Sports
Clutch
gang.
Sports. Put him in there. He need that experience with them good players. Put him in there.
This that CSG right here, man. Clutch Sports Gang, man. This is what they do, man. Salute the Clutch Sports,
I think
man.
They actually spell it with a K.
Oh, my fault. Yeah. So
they spell
it KSG. Oh, they so gangster. They don't even want to use a C. I see what they did right there.
Yeah, stuff right. Like, we do what
we
want.
You know what I'm saying? They on their blood gang, John. We ain't even going to use a C letter. So we Clutch Sports. You know what I'm saying? I see what they doing. I see how they popping. Anyway,
can't use a K, can't use a C. I mean, yo.
Yeah, that's another gang. Booking. Anyway, man.
Maybe K walking.
The Warriors straight played Cleveland and made sweet passion love to them and dominated them. After that, hold up though. Played the Spurs and they just Ben Roethlisberger'd them. To me, I know some people say it meant nothing, but. Going into that game, I would throw the Spurs. I don't know, front. I thought the Spurs going to humble these dudes. Boy, was I wrong. Steph Curry is drawn right now. There's nothing else I can say other than the fact that he's drawn.
And I thought it was going to be a good game even without Duncan. I mean, y'all know how I feel. I've always been a big Tim Duncan fan. But, you know, I still think Tim Duncan, he is getting the super benefit of the doubt from the fans because people still look at him. Because he's still on a team that's so successful, that he's definitely the best of his era right now. Like, Tim Duncan ain't been good in about 6 years. Like, he turns it on once every 3 weeks for the last 6 years, and the fans fall for that because the Spurs are always good. And I love Duncan. Like,
the way Aldridge has been playing, Tim Duncan will be playing at 62.
Yeah,
exactly. And people will be saying,
that's when Tim's going to
become the greatest player of all time.
Listen,
like,
all that
he's
is
be averaging
Dev,
like 6-6, and he's going to be the greatest of all time.
All that is, Dev, is the hatred of one Kobe, Michael Jordan, Bryant. That's all that is. That's all it is.
I know. I mean, people want Tim Duncan to be the best of the era, and he is top two or three in the era, no doubt, but it has nothing to do with what he's doing now. Like, Tim Duncan, you know, yeah, that's my man, but come on,
yeah. What do you guys think about the way the Warriors just dominated the Spurs, though?
I think the Spurs might have been a little scared from the jump. That's why you take Tim Duncan out. So if you lose, you have an excuse, but I don't think they thought they were going to get embarrassed either way. Or you can look at it another way. The Spurs don't like to really show their hand in the regular season, so maybe they got something for these dudes coming up. Even using that theory, though, you still don't go out there and let them embarrass you unless you really couldn't do anything about it. Because the Spurs rest players all the time, and they end up beating good teams when they do that. They don't go out there and just get embarrassed when they rest these dudes.
Fam, I mean, I'm gonna take Jimmy's approach and expound on that. It ain't just Steph Curry. That whole team is drawn. Like, the Mavericks, I watched the game last night. The Mavericks gave them that work for three quarters.
In the first half.
Three quarters. And then the Warriors went like this. Right, let's play, yo. We've been chilling long enough. Yeah, man. Come on, wake up. They was like,
you ready?
Like, yo, wake up.
I'm ready, Slick. Are you?
Boom, boom, yo, boom, wake boom, up. Boom. Yo, listen. And the game was close to like 5 points into the last third of the third quarter. And then in a matter of 10 minutes, the Mavericks don't know what hit them. And then they just rolled out and chilled. Yo, they put
ready,
they put the – yo, they –
You ready, Dave?
Yo, that team is scary, man. I need this. I need the 72. I need the 72 and 10 Bulls to hit that time machine.
If I were you, I'd take precaution.
Yo, if I were you, I'd take precaution.
Yo, the funny thing about that game is like, yo, I've seen Kawhi Leonard this season lock down everybody. I mean, lock down everybody. Yo,
Steph,
he got in front of Steph. He got in front of Steph. Yo, Steph embarrassing. Like, yo, because
he
didn't
made him fall.
Time, like,
on the move.
Yeah, mate.
Oh,
yeah.
Dog.
Yeah.
Just on the move to get the ball, he fell. Like, come on, man.
Yo,
he got the rocket.
Yo, he hit him with a hot sauce.
Yo, the great. Yo, the great Jamal.
Without the rock.
I hit him with the hot sauce. Yo, the great Jamal Crawford said that the reason that Steph is able to dominate like this is he's achieved freedom. He's free. He is emancipated. Yo, he said the boy's a man. He said, yo, Steph is out there doing whatever he wants, whenever he wants to do it, and it's not really outside of their offense. Like, he doesn't force it, but there's just times in the game where he just, yo, if I want to throw up a left-handed running scoop finger roll three-pointer, it's probably going to go in. Why not try? It's probably going to
go
in.
But he doesn't miss, though.
Yo, and he don't miss.
Yo,
Fam,
right now.
No, Fam is shooting 53. He's shooting 53% for three. Steve Kerr shoots 53% from three, but he takes like one per game. Yo, Steph takes 10 per game.
What is wrong with Eve? Yo, real quick though, let's get the homie Casey Mack. We're waiting for a minute.
Oh,
Casey
man.
Mack, Mavericks fan Casey Mack. If he's, you know, after he saw his team get embarrassed, Casey Mack.
Yo,
was
they
good.
Tried. Yo, they put up a good effort for three quarters. Yo, they tried.
Hey, all I know is, if we would have had Dirk, there would have been a fourth quarter. That's all I'm saying.
No, it wouldn't have.
You don't believe that. You don't believe that.
Is Papa Vic going to lose his job for getting blown out, too? Is he going to lose his job?
Casey Mack really said that nonsense, though, yo.
Well, we don't believe you. You need more people.
Hey, Casey Mack, Popovich. He down with Clutch Sports on the low. He's not gonna lose his job. No one is bigger than
Clutch Sports. Clutch Sports.
Hey, KSG
gang.
I want to pop up a boy, Coach Lou, Teron Lou. Teron's a Kansas City native. Went to high school, town high school, senior year. He went 30-1. The college person on his team was him. They were 6 feet tall. They run and gun.
Yo, he was the tallest person on the team?
40 minutes of hell. Or 32 minutes of hell.
Hey, Casey
Mack. No,
I'm
not talking Casey Mack. Like, 30-1,
yo,
they went?
It was
like,
30-1.
Was he that good, or is that saying something about the talent level?
I am telling you that.
Does he have like Down syndrome and they were playing against like other? Never mind. Listen to Casey Mack.
I don't care if you are Allen Iverson, Isaiah Thomas. If you're in Philadelphia and your tallest player, and we can say he's 6 feet all we want because he's not. If your tallest player is 5'10, 5'11,
you're going to die. You're going to die.
Everybody else
in that city
who played ball should be ashamed of themselves.
Hey,
Casey Mack, basically what you're saying is ain't no ballers in Kansas City. Y'all can't run rock. That's what you just said. But my point is,
he gave us
this man's whole biography, he's going to be known for one thing.
He went to high school. You remember the hood boy, Brandon Rush?
Yeah.
And big brother, Jerron Rush and Kareem Rush. He went against them. You remember Derek Hood that went to Arkansas?
Yeah, remember him too.
That's the game he lost to. He lost to Derek Hood. That was the game to get to the championship.
So they lost to an R&B singer?
Teron Lou a failure.
Well, if you want to call it a failure, I think it would have been, you know, 30-1.
But no, that 30-1 is crazy when you just tell this person on the team.
You know, it's disrespectful that KU didn't all of them a scholarship. They signed Jack Vaughn instead, so he went to the University of Nebraska.
That is disrespectful. So,
you know what?
Jack Vaughn was terrible.
If you ever look at all his stats, when he went against Jack Vaughn, he tore Jack Vaughn's ass up.
Yo, Hall of Fame is tearing up Jack Vaughn?
Yo.
Hey. Hey. Yeah. Go ahead and laugh at him.
Hey, Casey
Mack. Go ahead and laugh. But hey, this man that won 2 NBA championship rings on his tournament.
No, no. He has 2 NBA championship rings. I don't know about him winning 2 NBA championships.
Kobe, Shaq. Kobe, Shaq. I can sit on that bench and win 2 rings.
But what? Hey, we ain't asking Toronto to play right now. He's gotten under Phil Jackson. He hasn't been able to play.
Wait, are you here to spew this
I'm
home?
He's gonna be a good coach. That's all. That's all I'm saying.
Nah, he might be. No.
That's all
KC,
I'm getting at.
KC, I believe that. I believe that because point guards that sucked in the NBA usually are decent coaches. And he definitely sucks. So I believe that he'll end up being a
exactly.
decent coach. I believe
we have a theory in the
look
world.
Look at my man Kevin Ollie, get Rick Brunson.
Sit behind the superstar and absorb all that knowledge.
I believe he's gonna be a good coach.
It's the same
what I'm
thing
saying
in the NFL
he doesn't
though,
deserve,
backup quarterback.
He doesn't deserve
make, great
he doesn't
quarterback.
Deserve
look, it's a backup quarterback
position.
Coaching in the Super Bowl right now.
But you know what? You probably should have saw this coming because he was the highest paid assistant coach in the NBA.
Yeah, he was.
So when he
but,
was
but that was a part of the cool. that was a part of the story as well because they knew David Blatt was not going to be there and they knew that LeBron favored Tyronn Lue if he couldn't get the guy he wanted outside, so they gave him all of this money to be an assistant. The writing was on the wall from David Blatt from day one.
The point I was trying to make to you, KC Mack, is you can give us this entire man's biography. At the end of the day, he can win 3 straight NBA championships. Tyronn Lue is going to be always known for one thing. And you know what that is. I don't even got to tell you.
You know what it is.
I know.
You know what that dude from Virginia did to him.
So I still walked off with the ring. So I don't
he said it was luck. All 48 points that night.
All 48
points. Hey,
KC Mack.
I got to set the record straight, KC Mack. Some people win rings and some people get rings. He didn't win a ring. He got a ring. There's a difference.
And you know what? There's a lot of them that got a ring because a lot of them didn't win them. I'll tell you that.
Absolutely true, man. But thanks for the call. We about to get off the air in a couple minutes. We got some things to go through.
One question.
What's that?
Some people ain't roughing up Steph Curry. Rough him up.
I mean, people can rough him up. They can't catch him.
He's not as soft as his skin tone would belie. He's not. Del Curry was a gangster.
Everybody is letting them do anything he wants. Knock them on the way.
People try. They can't catch him and they can't stop him. It's like, yo, when you foul him, that's 4 points right there because he's going to throw it up from wherever he at, and that's his 4.
Let me tell you what makes this dude, and it's funny because we all marvel at his shooting, and that's what we all enjoy, I myself included. The thing that makes Steph Curry the murderer, the psychotic killer that he is on the basketball court right now, is the improvement in his passing. Because pick and roll basketball, when you trap him, his passing is next level now. Like his passing, so cats, like it's pick your poison. You don't really want to double him off the screens because it gives these other guys free run at the basket, open jump shots, dunks. So now if you don't double him, then you're going to be on a highlight on ESPN, and we're going to be talking about you.
Hey, they found a way to rough up Jordan. You got to take his confidence away.
That didn't work.
Jordan didn't have 9 other people that was out there playing at a high level.
Yo,
they got people coming off the bench that can use
Yo, KC, you actually just disrespected the Warriors because the Warriors team 1 through 10 are all starter quality. 1
right.
through 10.
But you know what? You got to knock that snake off his pedestal every now and then.
Yo, he's rolling with a guy who has better scoring potential than Scottie Pippen. I'm not saying he's a better player than Scottie Pippen, but the other Splash Brothers scored damn near 40 in a quarter. Like,
a lot of times now he's playing off the ball. He got Big Weldon bringing the ball up, so he's playing
Big
off the ball.
Big Weldon is nice.
Then you know what they need to do. There's nobody in NBA. There's nobody in the NBA that has. You have to have five fouls on you. Everybody on the team has to stop fouling.
Yeah, but
hit them all. Hit them all.
Foul
them all.
You're talking about a different NBA. You can't just throw people up in the 2016.
Yeah, you can't. There is no more Xavier McDaniel. Ain't no more Xavier McDaniels, bro.
They gonna break this doggone record of 72-10 easy because everybody's doing what the hell they want to do.
I don't think they're going to.
We're saying rough him up, but he is almost a 92% foul shooter. So you're gonna be playing yourself.
Yo, you said they're gonna break it easy. I don't know about easy, beloved, but I mean, you know, it is what it is. KC Mack, man, thanks for your call. Thanks for your support. We about to get out of here, though. Thanks for the call, homie.
I hate Denver.
We appreciate you.
He mad because they ain't win the division in a year. Y'all ain't sniff a division. FOH. That's why your coach can't control the clock.
What team are you talking about? The Cowboys or which one of his teams?
Oh my God. He like the Cowboys and the Indians. My fault. No. He's the Cowboys and Chiefs fan.
When he goes to see the Lone Ranger, he's rooting for both. He's rooting for the
Cowboys. Yo, my man KC Mack like the Cowboys and the Indians, man. Yo, anyway, with all that being said, man, we want to give a salute to the homie Shaquille Rashawn O'Neal, who's getting his own statue outside of the Staples Center, man. You know, I think it's deserved. He bought some championships and people forget, you know, because Shaq's such a clown, how dominant he was when he decided to get in shape. Those 3 years when Shaq decided to actually get in shape, oh my God.
I love how he found out. He was on the Jimmy Kimmel show, and the Lakers told Kimmel to tell him so they could tell him on air and get his natural reaction. So, you know, it was a cool moment watching him find out that he was getting his statue among the courtyard. Because if you've been to the Staples Center, you know, yo, everybody got a statue out there. They got like Kareem, Magic, some reason Oscar De La Hoya, Shaq.
Yeah,
they had to throw Shaq. You know, Kobe's gonna get his in a couple years. So
they got any more space?
Yo, Shaq. I don't know where they're getting it from. Because I think Logo got one out there. Elgin probably got. They got a bunch of statues out there. It's not that special.
There's a lot of things about Rashawn O'Neal, Twism, Leon Bordeaux that I don't like, namely the way that he did, you know, Mumia Abdul-Jamal, but we'll get into that later. I do like Shaq, man. Like, I respect this. I think it's a good
That's
move
a
for basketball. I think he's
right.
a funny he's a funny ball, man.
Hold up,
all right, but we gotta
yeah.
2016, he admitted liking Shaq and gave LeBron props. I just want to say Shaq, salute to you because you smash hoops and I always want to know what that smelled like. So, but anyway, it's time for us to get out of here. Thanks for joining us again in the warm, everybody. Shout out to everybody in the chat room, those on Facebook and Twitter, those who called in and got through. We definitely appreciate those we didn't get
and all
through.
Of
we
our
apologize
sponsors.
We ran out of time.
That are left.
Next week, same time, same place. Live right here on demand on the WRS Podcast Network. We have a lot of great sports talk. Next week, we're going to get into the Super Bowl. You know, we got 2 weeks, so we really didn't jump into it today. And we'll talk about everything else going on in the world of sports. We'll talk about whether Cam Newton has been assassinated by the KKK or not. Be sure to catch our conversations on Facebook and Twitter. Anywhere is at War Room Sports. If you want to hear anything that we do or look up any social media, go to warroomsports.com. Also, pick up my book, Sports to Book, which is at sportstobook.com or warroomsports.com. Until next time, everybody, don't accept mediocrity. Be steadfast in the war against ignorance, and we'll see you chumps on top.
All the blueprint.
Yo.
Every Thursday, 6 to 8, they do this. Shout out to Dez, PJ, Be Austin, Doc Bay on replay. WarRoomSports.com. Get that mobile app. If not, dial.
Call in.
323-14-0012. They've been going and you sensitive, then oh well.
Yeah.
Physical podcast, let's talk sports. Showtime like magic in the block push.
Magic.
Listen live, push one to join in. Rip your team or listen for your enjoyment. Hip hop dollars, pit stop and knowledge. Should be in sports credits, I ain't talking college. Five guys, no beef though. Corporate secrets, but the streets know. Belafonte, I got a G flow. KC, royalty, I'm in beast mode. 2 hours, get your game up. Who's the best in sports cast? You better name us. War Room Sports.
War Room Sports, www.warroomsports.com. What? Ain't no more to it.